and welcome to Avasant's Digital Forum, The New Age of Media, Driving the Digital Experience. This event is in partnership with Mindtree. My name is Andriana Albert, and I will be your MC today. Avasant is thrilled to have partnered with such an innovative organization to bring an hour of thought leadership and expert insights to our audience. Thank you again to Mindtree for your partnership. As we aim to make these sessions as interactive as possible, we encourage you to utilize the chat and Q&A features on your dashboard to post questions to the panelists. They will be answering your questions live throughout the session. It is now my pleasure to introduce you to today's moderator, Rob Devers. Rob is the former VP at Deluxe Entertainment and currently Senior Director and Senior Fellow at Avasant, leading our IT transformation and media and entertainment practices. Rob, welcome and thank you for joining us.
Thank you so much, Andriana. And hello, everybody. It's a pleasure to be here. Always a very interesting topic and actually one of my favorites. So what is going on in media and what is going on in the transformation to digital experience? As Andriana said, I lead the media entertainment practice, but like most IT leaders, I'm bilingual. I speak both languages. I also lead the IT transformation practice, or one of the leaders of the IT transformation practice here at Avasant, which is very important and very fortunate because if there is one industry that's definitely going through a lot of transformation, explosive transformation, and I think that's the word of the day, explosive, it's the media entertainment practice. Things are changing all over the place. So with that, let's go to our first slide. And as we look in this slide, and this is a way to make sense out of the media entertainment industry, just want to start with an analogy, a level setting. I was very fortunate to be introduced to media entertainment very, very early on, still when I was very young going to school. One of the major executives actually the chief editor for NBC was a mentor of mine and a friend of mine. And so in the 80s, he knew I loved math and he'd love to talk to me. And in the 80s, I think we had a theme of, they changed the pie chart again, Rob. What do you think about that? So let's, you know, if we put our minds back to the 80s, go, you know, okay, what's going on here? You start the 80s and here he was, he's partially responsible for delivering media entertainment of one of the major, biggest media entertainment franchises, NBC. Yeah, it can't be much bigger. But every year they'd come up with a summary. And back then in the day, it was how big of that pie? And you're just one of four pieces of that pie. NBC, ABC, CBS, maybe give PBS a little slice there. How big of that pie can you get? And that's it. And then he starts saying, what do you think about this? Cable came around. And now all of a sudden, there's MTV, there's CNN, there's all sorts of things popping up. But that was still the pie for the television. And he was saying, well, it can't change that much more. That's all you can get through the television. He asked me what I thought about it, and we were thinking about the future. And then he comes back the next year and went, you won't believe it. They changed the pie chart again. We have all ABC, NBC, CBS. We have now everything going on cable. But I'm competing for everything that's going on in the TV, everything. So guess what just popped up? Video games. I'm now competing against that. How do I do that? Oh my gosh, my world is turned upside down. What do I do? And it must have been very challenging when he's asking a 15-year-old kid, you know, what he thinks about this. So that was an inflection point, an explosive time then. But it was only coming through one TV, one medium. One way of going through things. And yes, there was a little bit more with cable. And yes, there was a little bit going on, but that wasn't as explosive. Now we go forward, you know, several decades, and that same thing is multiplied now by 1,000. It's not just a TV, the mediums have changed. It's, you know, it's not just a single, you know, standard customer. And actually, when you look at that, how you got something coming from a monolithic, a single organization distributing a video game or distributing content has now been turned on its ears. Everything has exploded. There's exploding content. There's exploding consumption, and especially the different ways that happens. But at the same time, there's an opportunity for specific personalization, for one-on-one understanding the customer of media entertainment, for sales, but also the customer getting more out of it because things are tailored to them. So that's a lot of what we'll talk about today is the explosion, but also navigating that and the personalization within it. There's two ways, once again, putting that hat on. We can look at this from a business point of view or a process point of view, and we can look at it from a technological point of view. We'll hit both. But let's look at, to make sense out of this, four areas we can lump things in to make sense out of a lot of the business point of view. We can look at the content, the customers, the emerging business models, and one other thing, the overall trust and safety that goes on and wraps around all this. So let's just do an overview, a look at each one of these. Content and customers, first of all. So we go to the next slide, please. Okay, so back to explosion. Right now, 3.8 billion people are currently online. Not just watching TV, we're currently online. And that's growing at 5% a year. Versus if we look at the old school, 2% decline in the traditional ways. So if we're looking at digital content demand, it's huge and it's exploding, but it's exploding in multiple you know, directions. You know, the old days of one type of way to look at something, you have changed. Now you have your digital OTT videos, you have online gaming, you have publishing, you have music, you could look at radio, and it all blurs across the board and they all feed each other. So the way that customers actually consume things is diverse too. Let's go to the next slide. Now you have diverse customers, people have diverse needs. And actually looking at what type of business model works, there are a myriad of solutions of actually how to actually navigate through this. You can do a subscription model where people are paying monthly or you know, some segment of time. You do the old school advertisement base. You could have a different tiered modular pricing model depending on what you wanted, and you'd buy, mix and match what you want. Or finally, you could go transaction by something. Or you could blur all that. And we've seen a lot of times the lead in here is often a free model that slowly evolves into one of these different models. So a lot of the question here, as a matter of fact, that's something we want to look at today is, you know, when do you apply which model? And what is the structure that you need to be able to do this? Okay, next slide. Finally, okay, I was starting with a story of the old days, and it was funny because it's quaint how this executive at NBC thought, you know, it was amazing how much the world had shifted, how much the world had changed. And really it was just using, to us, it seems like almost nothing, just a TV. It didn't change that much. But to him, it was a lot. It's funny for us, I look back now when we're looking at the concept of being safe and the word, we used to use the word security. And security, being safe, was somebody just not hacking your account. Somebody not just, you know, getting in and maybe getting to your bank account, but getting into your account and locking your account down. Now, you know, when actually media entertainment is so pervasive, we have to look beyond that in terms of the customer and actually what keeps them safe. And it goes beyond. Yes, there is the initial thought of making sure their account is safe. There's also a security on the delivery side, on the provider side, where you want to make sure that you're safe and the content is not pirated. But we go beyond that now. When you look at things, you now have fake news. You actually now, the different users, you know, might be exposed to cyberbullying. There might be all sorts of different things. And this is very important to the consumers and the folks that actually work with media entertainment. How do you actually address all that? And how do you bring all that together in a complex world is something now that we're dealing with. So with this, let's get into our event today. First, I'd like to introduce all the folks that are we're speaking with today, and we'll go down the line. First, Vivek, could you do an introduction, please? And you're on. There you go.
Sure. Okay. So my name is Vivek Bhargav. I've been in the digital advertising industry for almost 22 years. I sold my company to Dentsu Aegis Network Dentsu in India in 2012, and I was managing four of their performance agencies, about 1,500 people dovetailed into me. So I've spent 20 years helping large enterprises with their digital marketing, the digital advertising strategy. And it's been a very fascinating experience working across multiple clients all over the world on how they can use first-party data, how can they make the media advertising more effective on Facebook, on Google, on OTT platforms, and how do they actually use that first-party data to do sniper-based targeting. And I've just started a new company called ProfitWheel, which is basically a SaaS platform for first-party data of customers. Yeah.
Thank you so much. Bertrand.
Yes, good morning, everyone. So my name is Bertrand Leroux. So I was the former CIO of Activision Blizzard. I spent the last 30 years in the media and entertainment industry, and I work on leading very large-scale transformation initiatives, including technical innovation and digital transformations. And I work with so many companies, again, in the media entertainment, Vivendi, Activision Blizzard, and Disney. And so most recently, I was the CIO, global CIO for Activision Blizzard based in the US. And you know that within Activision Blizzard, you have the Blizzard divisions, but also King with Candy Crush, and also Activision Publishing with Call of Duty. So it was a great time where in less than maybe 10 years, we moved nearly 100% from physical to digital in this world, like many other media and entertainment company. And it was a very challenging time, as you can imagine. And we saw so many changing in this industry. And now, since about a year, I step down from that role, and I'm running my consulting business mainly in the video game industry.
Thank you so much. And Anthony?
Well, thank you, Rob, and good morning, good afternoon, and good evening to everybody joining us. My name is Anthony Caracol. I'm the Chief Business Officer for the Communications, Media, and Technology Industry Group at Mindtree. Our role is to advise our customers to reimagine their business models, leverage agile methodologies and digital technologies to accelerate their revenue growth and drive operational excellence. So it's a real pleasure, Rob, to be part of this panel.
Thank you so much, Anthony. As I look at my panelists, I think of that old cliche of if you're the smartest person in the room, you're in the wrong room. And I have no risk of that today. Great backgrounds and awesome thought leaders. So with that, let's ground. Let's start at the very beginning here. We've seen talk about explosive. There's been explosive growth in the last 3 years. Overall, what does this mean to the media entertainment industry? What is the biggest impact that you see? And actually, we'll go around the room with this. Bertrand, what do you see here?
I mean, of course, the new technology made a big difference in the last 10 years, but I think it's not only the technology or the technology allow to put in place a new business model. And Rob, you mentioned the explosive word, and I fully support that, because if I look at the video game industry, 10, 15 years ago, everything was physical. You were going to your Best Buy, buying your disc, and come back home, load your disc for hours, and then start to play. Now everything is digital. And of course, there is much more business model. So from a business side, so now you are going more to subscriptions, or you are going to microtransactions. And I think it's a big shift also on the business side, because now from a video game industry, instead of having this big hit at the end of the year, as an example, you can have a very more stable revenue stream across the year, which is much more easier to forecast, much better for Wall Street. And of course, the microtransaction make a big deal, because I think you can very quickly add new revenue in your world just by adding this microtransaction, which is 100% digital. So yes, technology make a big deal. And thanks to technology, which completely changed the world, how the content was distributed to our players.
Awesome. Vivek, what have you seen in terms of the explosive growth, and what is the impact here?
Yeah, so I'll cover the advertising industry and what the biggest changes that I see in this industry, right? First change is that direct-to-consumer sector is spending a lot more monies than what traditional sector used to send. So if a FMCG company earlier would spend 10, 15% of their revenues on advertising, a direct-to-consumer industry is spending almost 50 to 70% because they capture the entire customer lifetime value by acquiring the consumer. The other problem we're facing is at one side, demand is going up. At the other side, a lot of subscription services is reducing the supply. So if you take a Netflix or you take an Amazon Prime, there aren't too many advertising options available. So at one side, demand is going up. The other side, the supply is going down. So I think what's going to be the key requirement for large enterprises is what kind of marketing intelligence they can use to have a sniper-based approach to advertising, because you're not going to have the supply that you had earlier. Secondly, I think companies who are able to collect first-party data and utilize that first-party data to sort of transparently acquire the higher value customers who have large CLV, those are the companies who are going to prosper. And the companies who don't have an effective first-party data strategy are going to face tremendous amount of challenging times, because most of the marketplaces don't share with you the customers. If you see all the changes that Apple has done, so if you could be an OTT media publisher, but if Apple may not share who your customer is with the new IDFA update. So I think we are in exciting times, but also simultaneously challenging times. Companies were able to walk this balance of, you know, limited supply and increased demand by having a sniper-based approach are going to prosper, but it's going to be extremely challenging for many companies too. So these are my two bits on what has happened.
Great. Anthony?
Well, Rob, it's interesting. The media and entertainment market as a whole declined in the last year, right? Roughly about 4% based on a recent PwC study. But if you look at SVOD, streaming video on demand, and you look at virtual gaming, those grew dramatically. And in fact, the communication service providers reported a 30% increase in bandwidth or use of data in the past year. So, I mean, it's an exciting market if you are digitizing your business quickly enough. And that means the content supply chains, whether you're making a movie or making a game or publishing, you know, if you can digitize your content supply chains, if you can, as Vivek was saying, be laser sharp in targeting customers that, you know, are looking for the content that you're producing via direct-to-consumer platforms, for example, then I think you can take advantage of the tremendous growth opportunity in the media and entertainment space. But there is the risk of being disrupted if you're not able to reimagine new ways of doing things and leverage digital technologies to give your business a competitive advantage.
That's a really interesting point. As a follow-up to that, as you're looking at that, you're noting that even though there was an overall decline, you know, different areas have seen huge growth. And as a matter of fact, when we get the restrictions of COVID gone or something else like that, we probably have potential to go well beyond, you know, where we've been before. But it seems like you brought up in this the question here. It sounds like, are you saying a part of the key here is to be agile across the different types of entertainment? I mean, I'm noticing they're blurring a lot, or that's my, you know, would that be a fair? And if so, how do you do that?
No, I think that's fair. The lines are blurring. At one time, it was between communications and media. You had Comcast acquiring NBC Universal, for example. And then it was technology and media, Netflix and Amazon getting into content creation. So those lines are definitely blurring. And I think agility is a big part of it. Netflix was once providing, distributing DVDs to people via the mail. And now, of course, they have a direct-to-consumer platform that reaches over 200 200 million subscribers. So agility is definitely key for companies to succeed, and they have to pick their spots and find those areas where they can connect with customers. I would say Gen Z, and now increasingly Gen A, the alpha generation. My daughter is 10 years old. During the pandemic, she was one of the users of Roblox, which I'm sure Bertrand knows a lot more than I do. Apparently this company is 15 years old, but during the pandemic, it doubled its revenues and then went public. And now its market value is $45 billion. So yeah, I think if you have the right content and you distribute it in an agile manner to the right audience, then you can take advantage of the tremendous opportunity there is in the market to grow.
Awesome. Let's shift gears back and forth here between the business factors and the technology factors. What are the underlying driving technology factors that have caused all this to happen? So we understand, what's the driving force? Vivek, is this all due to increased bandwidth, increased storage? What are the factors that actually are causing this massive change?
Yeah, I think it's a combination of all these factors coming together. So generally, if you take earlier, exponential technologies didn't exist. So changes were linear. So let's say a steam engine improved transportation. That's very limited per se. When you take today, exponential technologies like whether it's 5G coming in, whether it's increased storage, whether it's increased one-to-one personalization possibilities, the way AI and cognitive sciences are developing, where you can have creative more effectively delivered at scale. So all these things are coming together and creating exponential scale, coupled with the lockdown and COVID, coupled with translation services of regional content becoming easy to produce. All these things are now creating this big opportunity for advertisers to use these things to get effective results. But I think the biggest change is that if you take the earlier distribution age, I would acquire a user, but I would pay the dealer and distributor and the intermediary is 50% of my production every month, even if the user bought my product for 20 years. Today, direct to consumer companies, you acquire a user. If you are able to retain him for the next 10 years, you make 50% more margin on him every month for the next 10 years. So now what happens is the cost of acquiring the user, if you can retain the user, is so much more affordable in terms of I can pay 5x of the user price. Now this opens new possibilities, like allows me to become a branded content producer and I can actually compete with publishers and media internet industry. Allows me to spend a lot more on advertising. Allows me to invest a lot more in data analytics, market intelligence, and basically all the tech that my money can buy. So what's happening is that because this fundamental change has happened, but you can now directly go to consumers, it has suddenly opened a lot more budgets and pipe coming in, which is allowing companies to transform the way they advertise, the way they acquire customers, retain customers. So I think it's a combination of this perfect storm that is creating this opportunity for people to use advertising more effectively than ever before.
Awesome. Bertrand, what can organizations do to keep up with the rapid change of the underlying technology factors? When you're at Activision or anywhere else, you have to plan out the next 5 years, what's going on. How do you plan for this? Or what can you do to keep up with these factors?
I mean, first, I think you need to do everything you can to be very agile and creative to take advantage of all this technology. I mean, as I mentioned before, the way the game industry changed in the last 10 years just by this physical to digital distribution was a big deal. So again, I mean, you need to be very creative, thinking out of the box, and also most of the time with this new technology, you start to have new businesses. And I will just give one example. If you look the mobile game now, which is the biggest, I would say, segment within the video game industry. In the past, I mean, when mobile was not so strong, when the gaming was not so strong on mobile, you were not touching a big part of the population in the world. So now with the 5G and just with the mobile, you can argue that nearly, at least maybe 70, 80% of the worldwide population have the phone, which means that now you can start to touch new territory, which was impossible before because you were not going to ship a disc in India or in Africa as an example, okay? But today you have a market there. And now with the mobile and the distributions, you can do so much stuff. So yes, when we start to saw that, that's where you need to change completely the way you are going to distribute your product. And again, if you look at another one, which is today when we are talking a lot about cloud gaming and streaming and so on. So I would say cloud gaming, it's like your Netflix, but from a gaming perspective, where at one point of time, you will not buy anymore a game and play on your PS5 or your Xbox and so on. You may argue now when your game will be in the cloud 100%, which exists already, by the way, you can play that on any device. So you still need a Sony PlayStation? Do you still need a Microsoft Xbox? Maybe not. Maybe a smart TV will make the work. So again, if you are there, you know that you have very strong partnership with Sony and Microsoft. What's going to be in the next 5 years? I'm sure they will still be there, but maybe consumer will go more to the smart TV as an example or mobile. So again, you need to be agile, very creative, and think out of the box.
Awesome. Now I noticed you've opened the door. You mentioned 5G. Anthony, what about 5G? You know, what should folks be doing? And we can combine these. You know, what should folks be doing, or can they be doing, or what's the potential that people can be integrating this into their operations to not only keep up but to provide new opportunities?
I mean, that's a great question, Rob. 5G is about speed, 100 times faster than 4G. It's about latency, 200 times better than 4G, one millisecond. And it's also about connectivity, 100-fold increase in the number of devices you can connect. And of course, it's about energy consumption, 90% less than 4G. So I think 5G will unleash a new wave of innovation, whether it's smart homes, cars, stadiums, concert venues, theme parks. Creators will be able to create and edit and roll out movies or games or news articles much faster, leveraging cloud and 5G. Consumers will be able to enjoy high quality content, new immersive and interactive experiences. It's exciting times. And as you rightly said, it's not just 5G, it's cloud, it's edge devices, it's AI, it's AR and VR. You know, a personal example, one that my daughter really enjoys, this ride called Soarin at Disney World, the popular hang glider ride. And I think of it as, what's possible if you leverage different technologies. So this is a ride that lifts people up in the air. It uses motion, it uses sense, it uses wind effects to create the sensation of flight in an 80-foot IMAX digital projection dome. So customers can take in aerial views of some of the world's most historic landmarks. But it's, it's basically helping you make the most of all your senses, not just sight and hearing, but touch and smell and taste. And so that's what I think 5G and all of these technologies will do for us, is create these truly rich, immersive, exciting experiences, Rob.
Great. Bertrand, any other thoughts of not just what 5G can provide, but what folks can do to prepare? And set up an infrastructure for it?
Yeah, I think, yes, 5G. I mean, and also I would just add that 5G, when we think only, it's most time it's about mobile, but I think 5G is much broader than that. I mean, you have also, at one point of time, any device will have 5G capability. So again, I think you need to prepare and look at this not only from a mobile perspective, but even from a company perspective, what does it mean? So, I mean, are we going to have a laptop with 5G everywhere? Now, I think that's what it will be at one point of time. Just to go back on the video game again, I mean, also with a big pipe on the 5G, you have nearly no download, and not to be too business centric. But again, if you look at the esport, which is a big also part of the video game now, I mean, with 5G, you will be able, nearly with no latency, to be able to have much more player playing together across the world. So again, you need to prepare for this infrastructure and be ready to take advantage of it.
Awesome, awesome. Vivek and Anthony touched on this, and you gotta keep going there when you start to think about 5G. Is there an opportunity? You have the convergence of the major technologies, you know, 5G, the use of the cloud, expansion, whether it's blockchain, anything else like that. When you put all those pieces together, are there synergies that are available?
Oh, absolutely, Rob. So just to add something, Anthony, what you said. So I'm a paragliding pilot. I trained in Salt Lake City in Utah. And what you're saying, I can so identify with it that if I could do it more safer, and I think AR and VR is just one aspect of it. The way I look at 5G is that the way we consume content, the way we consume content is going to change. Let's say an example, 5G will make driverless cars more efficient and possible. You combine that with immersive experience while during transportation. My father, when he would leave home, if he had forgotten his watch, he would come back to fetch his watch because he couldn't spend the day without a watch. Today, if I forget my mobile phone, I go back to get my mobile phone. I can't imagine the whole day without a phone. Tomorrow, there will be AR and VR goggles that all of us would be wearing. And if you forget it at home, the world would not be possible for us to manage, because your instructions, your menu systems, your driving instructions, everything will be driven by these devices that we carry. So 5G is going to make everything change. The way we consume media, the way we consume advertising, the way we engage with physical and virtual objects, what world, so the same building, even if you want to go to the washroom in a new building, if you don't have your AR gogs, there'll be nobody to give you instructions. So that's how you're going to manage the world. So I think the way we look at it is that it's just not 5G. It's going to connect the dots across 20 different things. As an organization, we need to be prepared for that world, because if we are producing content and we're not producing it, how is it going to be consumed, or what place and location is going to be consumed, then we'll never be able to produce the content that is going to be consumed in the future. So it is a disruptive technology which is going to disrupt 20 things, and we need to brainstorm and say, okay, how are we fitting into that world which is going to exist in the next few years?
Rob, if you don't mind, just a thought on 5G and new delivery platforms. You know, you think of the driverless car that Vivek spoke about. Americans spend an hour a day driving. This is pre-pandemic, you know, data, right? An hour a day driving, traveling approximately 32 miles. So if you think of it, it's about 70 billion hours of time spent driving every year by Americans. If level 5 autonomy becomes available, or if you ask Elon Musk when it becomes available, it's an opportunity for our many customers to create amazing in-car experiences, to generate new revenue streams as drivers become passengers. And an example of this is for one of the world's largest satellite radio companies. We are actually working with them to enhance the driver experience by creating a revenue stream beyond subscriptions. And this is in the area of enabling commerce through their in-car app. So think of it as you're driving through McDonald's and you're listening to music on your satellite radio in your car, but you know, you want to order a burger and some fries and a drink. You can actually do that through the in-car app, drive through, you know, pick up your food and be on your merry way. Or you can actually identify a parking spot, you know, again, using the in-car app, you know, in a busy city block, for example, you could find a parking spot and pay for it through your in-car app. And that's possible because you have a new delivery platform, in this case, a car, and then you have 5G enabling you to connect with, in this case, restaurants and, you know, providers of parking. So I think there are going to be some wonderful new use cases leveraging 5G and many of the exciting technologies that are available today.
Awesome. And you bring up, Anthony, such an interesting point, but back to the explosion, the delivery platform's changing. And one of my one of the most interesting ones is the car. Think about a captive audience there. You have a captive, I mean, they're there. You know, I think of it, you know, all the possibilities. Bertrand, whether it's in the car or other places, are there places, you know, that you're seeing that the media entertainment is exploding and there's different types of delivery platforms?
Yeah, I mean, the new delivery platform, I think what's going to be very big is all cloud, what we call cloud gaming, what I mentioned just before. So I think from a new distribution, I think that would be clearly the future there. So you would don't need anymore to download anything. It would be, again, your Netflix versus your Blockbuster. And I think that would be the big change. So now, of course, you need to have a great bandwidth, no latency, and maybe, as I said, new device. So that's something which will change. It's already there. I mean, if you look at many platforms, Google, Amazon, and so on, they already have this. I think from a publisher like an Activision Blizzard company, the question is on which platform you want to be. And now it's funny because as a consumer, I was the guy using the cable in the past. And then we say, oh, great, now we have Netflix. So, yeah, it's a great concept. And then the day after, I say, oh, by the way, you need to buy HBO. What about Disney Plus? What about this and this? So now you are back nearly from the cable time where you still have 20 options, okay, where you pay, by the way, 20 times the subscriptions, maybe still less than your cable. So my point being that we need to be very careful, again, to see where you will distribute your content, okay? Because people will not buy for everything. So again, going back to the video game business, if you decide maybe more to put your next big title, cloud gaming, on the Google platform, what about the Amazon one, okay? Can you do both? So that would be, I think, a lot of challenge. They will have to think about it.
Awesome. Vivek, any thoughts on platforms and cars? And matter of fact, how it even ties into marketing and advertising. I mean, you have somebody in a car and they're watching a show about a hamburger. You got them in a car. You could take over the car and drive them to a McDonald's. Any thoughts there?
So I think, Rob, the biggest change that is going to happen is the way advertising is sold. So if you take globally, even US or some of the other developed countries, only 1-2% of the gross domestic product is sold is actually spent on advertising. So if you have a $100 expense, you spend a couple of dollars, $3 on advertising. But if you take, a lot of companies have 20-30% margin. So they would be willing to spend 10% of their margin as in cost of sale. So the way I look at it is, advertising is an expense, but cost of sale, in a way, goes in the balance sheet. So you don't have a budget. You want to spend $1 billion a day for someone. As long as you give him $10 billion of sales, he would not mind paying you $1 billion. So now what happens is, if that is the concept we're looking at in monetizing advertising, then, as Anthony mentioned about ordering a burger, so you're not paying for advertising. If the consumer takes it, McDonald's pays 10% of its sale value for advertising. Similarly, for direct-to-consumer companies are willing to spend 50 to 70% of their sale price to acquire a customer. So what publishers will have to do is that they'll have to figure out that what products to sell to which consumers that you get maximum value in terms of acquisition, and make your pricing based on that. The other biggest challenge that I think publishers are going to face is that it may suddenly become viable for brands to build their own media platforms. Because if I'm a luxury brand and I'm going to be selling my products to only a few million customers in the world, then it may make sense for me to create branded content targeting only 5 million people in the world. Now, because I'm going to monetize each of those customers significantly in large values over a lifetime period, it may be affordable to give them content for free. So I think the advertising landscape is going to change where people start, instead of trying to reach out to 600 million people through large platforms, how do I have a sniper-based approach? And this is where marketing intelligence will come in, matching influencer platform audiences with your audiences will come in. But I think the key is going to be, can you make your advertising as a cost of sale? If you can succeed out there, then I think you can make a lot more money as a publisher. And the brands will be happy to pay you that money.
Awesome. Well, we're getting a lot of good questions on the customer, on the business side, but there's one thing that's hanging out there on the technology side we have to talk about first, and that's blockchain. You know, blockchain, does blockchain have a role, or what is the current and what's the predicted role for blockchain? Anthony, what do you see?
No, I think blockchain definitely has a role to play in the media and entertainment industry. If you think of NFTs, non-fungible tokens, and you know, digital art that is being sold by artists that may not be as well known for tens of millions of dollars, I think absolutely NFTs and blockchain have a role and will help creators of content monetize that content. So it's early days, but from our perspective, we are coming up with new business models, new use cases in what we call Digital Pumpkin, which is essentially our design thinking workshop, where we imagine the future or reimagine the future and bring together new business models, new technologies in order to help our customers grow, adapt and grow in the current environment. So I think, yes, absolutely, blockchain has a role to play, particularly in the area of digital selling.
Yeah, awesome. And as a matter of fact, I'll tie that in. We do have a viewer question talking about, is from Bob Parker, saying, hey, well, you know, legal administration is getting much more complex. We have Scarlett Johansson suing Disney. What should media entertainments do to modernize royalties and rights management? And is blockchain is the killer application for that? You know, could this be solved or partially solved with blockchain? Bertrand, have you, looked at this at all in your experience?
I mean, I've not looked personally under my time at this, but it was coming, because yes, before, the right management system was always the same one where you try to get all the royalty for all the artists or the licensee, the licensor. So it's a pretty complex business. So yes, I think from a blockchain perspective, I mean, that should help a lot, but I think it's just the beginning. Because also if you look, not only I think the video game, but the content generations, I think will change. Today, again, on the video game business, it's more the studio publishing the content for the game or the film studio developing the content for a movie. But maybe at one point of time, you will start to have more user content, and maybe these user contents may have some value and you want to track that value if it's used somewhere else. And I think maybe the classical system we have today will not be able to track all of this to make 100% sure who is the owner, we should get a royalty and all of this. So blockchain, I think, will play a big role. And to go back to the other question more on the NFT, I think same thing on the video game business. You may argue that you can have maybe a new avatar, which would be more NFT. Or maybe why not, if you look new business model, why not selling a specific artwork from your development studio you didn't use during the for the game and sell it as an NFT, I mean, as a unique piece of artwork like we do today, physically selling a figurine or selling a cell from Disney from a cartoon, as an example. So I think there will be a lot of stuff going on in this space of blockchain and NFT. Yeah.
Okay. Awesome. And Vivek, anything else? Good. Blockchain.
So the way I look at it, right, that today I have this physical object, let's say a phone, I give it to you, I don't have the phone anymore. So what blockchain does is it solves this problem of double spend. I have a photograph, I give it to you, now I no longer, I still have it, you have it, the blockchain stores it. So in advertising, I think it's going to be very, very relevant, because if I'm going to charge companies based on cost of sale, and it's going to be significantly more than what I'm paying for advertising, the measurement of that is going to be extremely critical. And I think blockchain is a very, very effective platform to use to measure and calculate the attribution, which medium should get the attribution for the sale. And the entire customer lifetime journey, if it has to be measured accurately, blockchain comes in very effective. Even from a content perspective, you could almost have blocks of content being transacted on blockchain. So you're paying for the amount of content you consume. So I feel that today we don't call that this is an electrical object or a connected object. The same way, blockchain is going to become an underlying technology where most of the industries will use it in some form or factor, but you won't call it they're using blockchain. It's just hygiene. So that's the way I look at it. And it's, I think the measurement is one big problem solve that blockchain will do for the advertising industry, especially if you're looking at cost of sale as a metric of payments, then blockchain will be very, very critical for the advertising industry.
Great. Well, let's shift over to the customer. And while everything's exploding, working with the customer, what are the trends, Anthony? What are the trends that you see in dealing with the customer and personalizing with the customer, knowing your customer, both for delivering better content and also looking on the other hand of monetizing things?
I think, Rob, that's an excellent question. They say content is king, distribution is queen, I guess, and data is the princess. Data is absolutely critical to the success of any media and entertainment company. Mass marketing is not effective. We all know that. So customers expect, relevant, personalized content in a timely manner. And so I think it's important for M&E companies to learn from companies that are really great at personalization. Take, Amazon or Microsoft or Netflix or Spotify, who leverage transaction data and collaborative filtering to understand customers' buying behaviors and create customer delight and thereby accelerate revenue growth. An example of this is we helped one of the largest technology companies in the world build an advanced analytics engine to predict the effectiveness of ads on their search engine. They wanted to do this because they wanted to enable advertisers to understand the reach, understand the brand interaction, understand conversions for ads, that were that came up on search. And so as a result, advertisers were able to personalize ads and maximize sales effectiveness. Or if I think of a Fortune 500 hospitality company where we help them integrate data across multiple brands so that, this particular company could create personalized offers for their guests. It was really a 360 degree view of their customers and their spending patterns so that, when they booked a hotel room, they would get a voucher to their favorite restaurant, or they would get, a golf experience at a nearby golf course. So it's really creating a 360 degree view of your customer and then leveraging that data to be able to serve your customer exceptionally well. And that creates delight, it creates loyalty, and, ultimately profitable growth in this case for this hospitality firm. So personalization is absolutely key to every media and entertainment company's success.
Awesome. Bertrand, anything in the gaming world that is used to enhance that understanding, that one-on-one relationship with the customer?
Yes, I mean, even when Vivek, you were talking about the third party and so on, I think the good thing is for a lot of media, if you look at video games or the Netflix and so on, now you have this direct relationship with them. You know exactly what they do. And if I will specify more on the video game, you know, when the people are playing, at what time, with who, where they are, how many people they kill, how many times they have been killed. And so if you have the right data engine to analyze all this data, I think you can do two things. Is one, you can be much more have some sort of one-on-one marketing with every single player, so you know what they do, and maybe they are always lacking on one map. Maybe you want to give them like a credit, a gift, or something just to pass this level, so they will still keep very attracted by the game. But also from a development standpoint, if you realize analyzing your data that a lot of people are having issue in one part of the game, maybe you need to change the game, okay? Or change the way people are playing. So I think with this data analytics, you can do so much stuff. But I agree also with Anthony, I mean, personalizing the content is great. And I'm not sure if it's 100% correct, but even in the movie industry, why at one point of time, based on what the people like, why you will not change the end of the movie, depending on of what type of person you are. So you can go very far away. It's not for tomorrow, but maybe Rob, you will look one movie and I will have a different end story that you, based on what I know you like when you watch a movie. So that's things will happen.
It's interesting. I've never thought of that before. Wow. Mm-hmm. Vivek, for the one-on-one experience, what things can we do to enhance it?
So I think this is actually the fundamental problem we are trying to solve as Profit Bean. The challenge is that most large enterprises don't know their customer well, other than what the customer has done with the enterprise. So if I bought something or I subscribed to a certain channel, I just know that information. So what we are attempting to do is that there are a lot of social signals that come from Facebook, from Google, from D360, from YouTube. So what we try to do is we're trying to create almost like a Tinder for first party data. If you tell us this is your high value customers, we should be able to tell you which are the platforms, what kind of affinities you should target, what kind of influencers you should hire who have maximum overlap with your customers, what kind of cities and pin codes you should be able to target, because those pin codes are consuming most amount of content which is matching with your high value customers. So I think the more and more we look at a sniper-based approach, it is going to get critical. It may not happen on a one-to-one basis. It may happen on a segment or a cohort basis. Mm-hmm. But I think this is the holy grail for advertising. How do we take your best customers, and then how do we find transparent lookalikes of those customers who give you most of your profits? They say that 20% of the customers give you 200% of your profits. It's much more than the Pareto principle. So how do we ensure that we look at that 20% of the customers and help you find similar customers across the different platforms, including influencers that are available to you? So I think this is the holy grail problem that we are trying to solve as a Profit Wheel. I think this will deliver tremendous sort of value to customers.
Awesome. Okay, we have one last question for Anthony from a viewer question. And then I'm going to prep you. I always like to end it with a lightning round. And you usually have a media and entertainment theme. Like to think of it as if you're doing a tweet, and a modern tweet, 280 characters or less. So before we ask the last question, the lightning round will be on trust and safety. And where are we going in the world in trust and safety? What should you do? Lightning round, though, in a tweet. But before that, we do have one remaining viewer question, and back to the customer. There's evidence that they're facing subscription fatigue. What can Anthony do to better engage their audience, or what business model might work there?
That's
is semi lightning too. 1 minute.
Yeah. Interesting question. Not an easy answer, I think. I would suggest keep adding value. If I think of my own experience using Amazon, it was initially for shopping, and then it's, you know, for movies and, you know, gaming and all kinds of things. So I think the best way to overcome subscription fatigue is to ensure that you're providing continuous value to your customers, in which case, you know, they, you know, really see the return on investment.
Okay. Awesome. Okay. Lightning round. Let's talk trust and safety. And we could go on, this could be a whole nother topic. Maybe we'll do this, you know, in a month or so. But trust and safety, if you put this in perspective, you know, if we look at this century, folks have said the differentiator of the 21st century is globalization. COVID was the great accelerator, but social media is the great divider. What can folks do in technology? In a tweet, what would you advise everybody? What can folks do in technology to improve their trust and safety stance? And we'll start with you, Vivek.
So I feel that advertising becomes more effective when you use the data of the customer to make some add some value in his life. So if you're providing additional value in his life, whether it's through advertising, that's great from a trust and safety point of view. So that's my 1 minute answer on that. Provide value to the consumer, they'll trust you with their data.
Great. Say that last quote again. Do what? And they'll trust you with the data?
Provide value.
Provide value and they'll trust you with the data.
Yes.
Okay. Bertrand?
So I will say for the trust and safety, listen to your consumer, stick to your word, look very carefully privacy, and be ethic. That would be my 2018.
Awesome. And Anthony?
No, I couldn't have said it better. Spot on. Completely agree with what Bertrand said. If you're authentic, you're straightforward, you know, you care about your customers, they will trust you and stay with you for a long time.
Well said. Well said, all of you. That's the thing where I think we've gotten to now. It's not about the technology anymore. It's about knowing your customer and being concerned about their safety across the board. So great advice, everybody. Thank you so much. If anybody has any questions, I think Adriana will take it from here and give the details of how they can connect with everybody here. Once again, thanks so much. Really interesting session.